Welcome to the InfoWars Nightly News. I'm your host, Jakari Jackson, joined in studio by Joe Biggs and also Rob Dew. This is our Memorial Day special. It is Monday, the 25th, 2015. We have some special reports that we pulled out of the vault. But before we get to those, I want to talk to the gentlemen and see what they think about what we've done thus far this year. We'll start with you, Joe Biggs. What do you think about the reporting we've had a chance to do in 2015?
I mean, it's been a very eventful year. I mean, as soon as I got here, the first project that was being worked on really huge was the Bundy Ranch thing. Mm-hmm. So I came in right as that was happening. I mean, we're going from Bundy Ranch to Fort AP Hill to Murrieta with the standoff of the illegals to Ferguson twice, Baltimore. I mean, here we are now. I mean, it has been an epic year. That going down to Mexico looking for ISIS. I mean, it's been an intense time here at InfoWars.
Showing that the river can be crossed at any time.
Oh, yeah. I mean, and going out and proving time and time again at the border, you as well with Kit Daniels and Adon and myself, and, you know, showing that the border is pretty much non-existent, and the fact that our government continues to let these people come over. Meanwhile, you know, we go to a checkpoint 126 miles away from the border, mm-hmm. and we're harassed. We're asked if we're American citizens, but they bust these guys in with no paperwork, no loyalty to our country whatsoever, and they're given a free pass everywhere.
And it just came out that there was a lady who made a short video, and that's the great thing about people with their cell phone cameras. She saw a FEMA bus. She asked them, what are you doing? They were taking Africans over to a federal penitentiary. They came in seeking asylum, so they take them there first to, I guess, figure out who they are. I guess if they're criminals, they let them stay, and if they're not, then they send them back because they know it's been proven that they're letting out the criminals, the illegals that are criminals. They're letting them just out on the streets. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, so all that and so much more. We don't have time to talk about it all, but we will talk about a few selections that we all picked out, a few of the guys picked out a few of the videos, and we'll start with one I made. Now, I sometimes make show intros for the Alex Jones Show, and this one was one of my more recent ones. It's called Cocaine Blues. It's the tale of the CIA.
We must wage what I have called total war against public enemy number one in the United States, the problem of dangerous drugs.
Took a shot of cocaine and away I run.
But William Robert Tosh Plumley is our guest.
I've been called over the years the CIA's Forrest Gump. When I'm starting flying cocaine back into this country to carry on an operation in violation of the Bolin Amendment, I began to have a little bit of a conscience about that.
The Reagan administration's determination to sell arms secretly to Iran and to help guerrillas fighting the Marxist government of Nicaragua despite congressional objections was the engine that drove the Iran-Contra policy. Secretly, Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North devised a scheme to finance the Contras by overcharging Iran for the weapons.
You're an anti-terrorist expert. Iran was officially a terrorist state. You went around telling...
I wanted Mr. Buckley out of there.
And if you're not with them cops and military, then you will declare that you're with the Republic now.
I am a former Los Angeles police narcotics detective, and I work South Central Los Angeles, and I will tell you, Director Deutsch, and the agency has dealt drugs throughout this country for a long time.
Mr. Webb, I was wondering if you have ever gotten a chance to look into the rumors and reports that MENA, Arkansas, was a major drug shipment center during the 80s.
For those people who don't know, there was a major drug trafficker named Barry Seal who was based his air fleet at MENA, which is a tiny little airport up in the mountains of Arkansas.
Russell Welch, criminal investigator for the Arkansas State Police.
Did Barry Seal ever say to you, I work for the CIA?
He said he was had worked for the CIA.
Unit 5 has learned in the early 1980s, even before his arrest, Seal had bought one of his planes from a CIA front, Air America. The plane was used by Seal for drug smuggling, and the CIA company was paid in the traditional drug dealer fashion of $300,000 in cash.
Last night in Louisiana, Barry Seal's enemies caught up with him and killed him. Tonight, three men are in custody. NBC's Brian Ross reports that Seal was about to testify for the government once again.
Well, how you think the crack rock gets into the country? We don't own any planes. We don't own no ships. But we are not the people who are flying and floating that in here.
Back when this all first came out, people didn't believe the CIA was bringing drugs in.
I didn't believe it. Even when Gary reported the story, and I was like, this guy Gary, what is he talking about? I was involved with the CIA, and no way. It wasn't until the CIA themselves put out their report. I mean, that was when it really hit me that, hey, Gary was right.
And Jakari, you did that intro without any prompting. You just kind of took it upon yourself collecting graphics and stuff. But back on Friday, I covered a story when I was sitting here with Alex, and it was about the DEA got busted. Two DEA agents were running a strip joint where people, they had Brazilian and Russian immigrants, illegal immigrants. And they, these people were also paying, having, you know, selling their bodies for sex. And that was all documented. And it's amazing that this goes on in our government. And people don't believe it. People refuse to believe it, especially on the right side. They like to think the government is perfect in some ways. And the left likes to think the government's perfect in others.
But like if we get caught doing that, we're thrown in jail.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. If we were running a strip joint where people were paying for sex, that's prostitution, we would get in trouble. And yet DEA agents are doing it on DEA time. And they were checking
probably trafficking involved in there as well. Everything.
Totally. Yes. You know, drugs. They're involved in this stuff. Yeah. And it all just kind of floats around undercover. And it's only when they're caught and they probably did something wrong, pissed off the wrong person, so they got outed. You know, those who abide by the code get to keep operating.
Yes.
Yeah, it's disgusting.
So let's move on. What do you guys have?
Well, I have, since it's Memorial Weekend, I have a report that has to do with the Watson program that IBM has kind of gotten cahoots with the VA with. And it's this robot brain that's going to take over the VA death panels.
Focus, and 3, 2, 1.
Tonight, IBM, friend or foe, IBM has been announced as the winner of a long-term VA contract to modernize the electronic health records management system for the embattled VA. IBM will utilize the latest technology to provide up-to-the-minute care for veterans all across this great country. The VA released a statement, "We are serious about health of our nation's heroes and are sparing no expense to update, modernize, and create an efficient system to diagnose and provide real-time healthcare solutions for those who have served our country. We thank IBM, a company that has a long history providing cutting-edge information technology solutions, for stepping in, providing leadership and experience that will be valuable to our country and save taxpayers money." Hold on. This isn't who we are. Nah. Give me those freaking cue cards, man. Ah! You know what? You know what's gonna happen with this? You know what the implications are of this Watson program that's gonna come up? It's a computer that they're gonna use to replace the doctors at the VA to do the death panels that have been going on, to help take away human emotion from making those decisions. This is something that's gotta change. This is ridiculous, and I'm Joe Biggs with Infowars.com, and I'm not gonna take it anymore. I'm standing outside of the Veterans Affairs Center in Austin, Texas. This will be the proving ground for IBM's brand new technology, Watson. Now what that is a supercomputer that will have all of your medical records, admin records, and many other things downloaded into it. They want to use this machine to replace the doctors that have had death panels going on at the VA for years now. Newly released documents expose more explicitly the details of IBM's pivotal role in the Holocaust. All six phases, identification, expulsion from society, confiscation, ghettoization, deportation, and even extermination. Moreover, the documents portray with crystal clarity the personal involvement and micromanagement of IBM President Thomas J. Watson and the company's co-planning and co-organizing of Hitler's campaign to destroy the Jews. Why is the Department of Veterans Affairs awarding IBM with a large contract to bring in Watson, a new technology that will be used to replace doctors in an already failing VA health system? Why are they naming it after Thomas J. Watson, the founder and president of IBM? Did you know this man was responsible for making the machines that created punch cards with a coding system to label and eventually kill thousands of Jews? This machine would generate codes to be tattooed on prisoners in Hitler's concentration camps. This man committed genocide by any standard, and IBM and the VA want to throw it in our face clear as day and name it after that monster. If this doesn't piss you off, I don't know what will. Hitler was so impressed with what Watson had done for the Third Reich that he awarded him with a special award, created specifically for the occasion, to honor extraordinary service by a foreigner.
The medal was the Order of the German Eagle with Star, bedecked with swastikas, and was to be worn on a sash over Watson's cold, dead heart. Why do they want to put a machine in charge of your health, you might ask yourself? They do it so this pre-programmed evil robot can make the life or death decisions about you, the veteran, instead of the doctors that have received so much flack from the VA scandal over the last year. This helps take human emotions away and also allows the medical personnel to use Watson as a scapegoat should any problems arise, like death. Watson will be a new form of medical AI technology used to run the death panels already in place at the VA. How soon will it be until this technology moves over into civilian healthcare? Will you be a victim of Watson's wrath? This is also happening in another area of the government. They now want to replace humans that fly drones and make them fully autonomous. And many pilots were also claiming PTSD. Once you take the human aspect out of dealing with healthcare and war, things become even more evil. Who is going to check the morals of the men and women who program these machines? How do we know the machines will be told to act ethical and make the right decisions?
Well, there you have it. That is the new Watson technology that's going to run the death panels at the already failing VA healthcare system. Now I have a vision of how this Watson technology will be implemented when you walk into the VA. Let's go in here and take a look.
Next.
What's going on?
All right, right arm. All right, Watson has determined you need to step in the medical chamber. So, go ahead. Next.
And the interesting thing about that, we all have computers, we all have phones. You experience a computer glitch, your phone freezes, you have to restart it. So what makes people think that some big IBM computer is going to be immune to that? That mistakes will not be made, whether it's with that or with self-driving cars. Mistakes do happen, and then it's going to be whose fault is it? Is it going to be IBM's fault?
Well, what will happen is they'll kill a bunch of people, or they'll line up a bunch of people in these death panels and then go, oh, it was a glitch. We didn't know. Now we're fixing it.
Well, if people don't expect, if people don't expect it to be a death panel, just look at the history of the guy it's named after.
Yeah. Watson was creator of the program that was a tattoo machine. Yeah. And it's just that. And that's another example of it just being right in your face and government colluding with total criminals to just try to run people's lives. I've got one kind of branching off that. It was a report called Will Google Use Aborted Babies in Their Quest for Immortality? I put this out in March. And it kind of talked about Google and their life extension technologies, how they're investing in that. And then there's this company in California that's taking aborted baby organs and then growing them to transplant size. So now that's going to be their new excuse for more abortions is, well, hey, we're going to take these and reuse these unwanted babies for people who are already alive, and now we're going to help them. And I just think it's totally disgusting. Last week we were out at the abortuary, the Planned Parenthood over on South Congress, you know, really trying to shed light on this.
It's not just the history of Planned Parenthood, but also their founder, Margaret Sanger.
Right. And then we had the commies come out who were pretending like they were anarchists and just totally for this, supporting a known racist while calling us racist.
Yes.
Ridiculous. So I, you know, we'll go to that report now. And then I guess we have more to talk about.
How old are you in real time?
28.
I'm 105. If you had as much time as I have, what would you do with it?
If I had all that time, I sure as hell wouldn't waste it.
The movie End Time seems to be a perfect metaphor for what's going on in our daily lives now. We don't seem to ever have enough time, even though with all this great technology and all these advances, we're still always running behind, trying to catch up, never getting enough done.
Come on, help yourselves.
Take the time, it's free.
You put enough time in the wrong hands, you upset the whole system.
Let's hope so.
Well, Google may have a solution for that, as they do for everything else. In fact, there's a Google executive that thinks we could live to be up to 500 years old. Bloomberg Business reported that Google Ventures CEO is in the search for immortality. That's right. Bill Maris has up to $425 million a year that he could spend on venture projects out there, and he's looking for companies that will slow aging, reverse disease, and extend life. Google Ventures has close to $2 billion in assets under management, with stakes in more than 280 startups. They fund things like Google Glass, driverless cars, SpaceX, and Google X is working on a pill that would insert nanoparticles into our bloodstream to detect disease and cancer mutations. But how will we pay for this immortality, and what will be the cost to you and I? Will it be through xenotransplantation, where they take actual organs from aborted babies and grow them inside rats and other animals, and then implant them into you? Do you want to be responsible for the death of another human being so you could live longer? Well, there's a biotech company in Redwood City, California, which is doing just that. The California company Ganogen removes the organs from aborted babies, transplants them into a rat or pig, and allows them to grow so they can be transplanted into a human. Work has initially been done on kidneys. WorldNet Daily seems to be one of the only publications talking about this. They have a couple articles. One, scientists grow kidneys of aborted babies and animals, an aborted baby organ program called Franken-Science. This is one way we're turning our children into commodities, and they're not even being born yet. Now, after they're born, we have the CPS that goes around and traffics children. In fact, Los Angeles Department of Children and Family Services is under state investigation. The LA Department of Children and Family Services has been under fire in recent years with official commissions investigating high-profile deaths of children who've come in contact with the foster care system. Investigators are looking into allegations that officials in Los Angeles DCFS office engaged in a series of baby trafficking activities and cover-up extending back 15 years involving possibly large numbers of babies. And these kids had a high price tag. They estimate the 21,000 kids that went through this system, they were getting $25,000 apiece for them and taking them out of the system and transferring them to families with these large fees. And so the supervisors are getting kickbacks, the employees are getting kickbacks, so what they need is more kids. So they go after your family. Oh, you don't want vaccines for your kids? Maybe we're gonna call CPS. Oh, you don't wanna treat your kid for eczema using the steroid cream like the CPS recommends? Well, we're gonna take your kids. And that's what happened to a family in Washington State recently. They had a home birth of twins, and they didn't wanna bring them to the doctor because they felt their kid's immune system hasn't been developed yet. Well, due to pressure from their family, they called the paramedics to come check on their kids. The paramedics said the kids are fine, but they recommend they bring them to a doctor. And they said, no, we're going to wait till their immune systems get better. Well, the next day, CPS shows up and goes, hey, your kid has eczema. We recommend this steroid cream. And they go, well, we're treating it with natural antibiotics and creams like coconut oil. And they said, no, if you're not using the steroid cream, we're going to take your kids. So they took their kids for a while. Then they got them back. But now they're under investigation. They're under the heel of the CPS. And if they don't march and cross every T and dot every I, they're going to come and take their kids. And because of that oppression, they decided to flee the state. Well, then they got busted down in California. And before being arrested, the mother, Carrie Ringo, actually told a cameraman, send a message to America for me. Children don't belong to the government. The government belongs to the people. When our children become commodities, it lessens their value. You can't put a value on human life. You really can't. Although they're trying to do that with this healthcare system where they're going to have to budget healthcare for you and we may have to create death panels. They're trying to put a price tag on human life. They're trying to say some lives aren't worth as much as others. And pretty soon, hey, like Will.i.am said in Rolling Stone, eventually 3D printing will print people. In fact, here's his quote. You can print in freaking protein. You can make freaking meat. You can print leather. You can print a liver. So if you can print a liver or a kidney, God dang it, you're going to be able to print a whole freaking person, and that's scary. Yeah, that is scary. We may split into that human species, that subservient class and that master class, a lot earlier than H.G. Wells ever predicted. So try to remember that when you see headlines like Google exec says we can live to be 500 or forever, or we're going to merge with machines. Look at the human cost now and ask yourself, is it worth it? This has been Rob Dew for InfoWars.com and InfoWars Nightly News. So I think it's really interesting that Google is really investing in this life extension technologies, but how far will it go? Will they start investing in companies that are using aborted baby organs to grow transplant organs? I mean, that is a definite philosophical question, and that's a bridge we're definitely going to have to cross very soon, sooner than later, I think.
It sounds sci-fi, but it's real and happening. It's not something that may happen 20 years from now. These are concerns that affect us right now in the real world.
Yeah.
Joe.
Well, I have another video. This one was titled Someone Dies at the End. And this goes back to the progressive snapshot, a little device you plug into your car, and it's supposed to record whether or not you're a safe driver, your speed limits, all this stuff. So I did a report a while back showing you how this thing can be hacked. Someone could take over your vehicle, speed it up, shut off the engine, turn on the wiper blades, and all that. And I also tie it into my really good friend Michael Hastings' death. So it's a really well report, and the snapshot's back in the news right now. Didn't you say that
people are actually suing Progressive because it's causing their cars to short out? It's screwing up their electrical system. So this thing is not a very good product that they've created, one. And two, the spy implications in it. And then there's other implications. Now, Oregon is talking about taxing people by the mile. They're going to be one of the first states to start this program. And that's where it's all going, tracking you through your black box. Mm-hmm. They want people to update their cars. They don't like old cars on the road because they want to push us to this driverless thing. And that's all part of
controlling part
of what your report is. Yeah, because they're going to say, oh, humans make too many mistakes. We got to have driverless cars. And then, you know, you have no control whether you live or die, which kind of at the yeah. your report, somebody dies at the end.
All right, well, let's take a look at the report. Someone dies at the end.
Joe Biggs here with InfoWars.com. Now, back in 2011, we wrote an article here at InfoWars talking about the progressive auto insurance dongle, the snapshot. Now, what that is a device you plug into your car that allows Progressive to see whether or not you are a safe driver. It monitors your speed, your braking habits, all of that good stuff, and it sends the information back to them and lets them know if they should lower your insurance or not. Well, here we are, 2015. And we now know, based off of Forbes and the Hacker News, that this is a device that can be easily hacked into. They can stop your brakes, accelerate your car, and do pretty much whatever. Now, we all know the incident that happened with my friend Michael Hastings, where his car just shot down the road, exploded, hit a tree. This is something that we live in now, a digital age. We are now at a point where almost every car is able to be hacked into, because we have these computer systems inside it. Now they're trying to get you to plug a device into your car that will actually allow hackers to get into it. So just a few days after Michael Hastings died, I received in the mail from Progressive Auto Insurance, because that's who I had at the time, was this box that said the snapshot. Open it up and says plug it in your car and get your insurance rate lowered. Well, I threw that away because I was disgusted by the fact of what just happened to my friend. I didn't trust anything being put into my car. But wonder what would happen if I hadn't thrown that away and I actually plugged that device into my car.
Hey, what you looking at?
What's going on?
Well, you look like you're here to save some money on your car insurance.
Yeah, I don't know what I should get. I was checking the snapshot thing out. What do you mean? What do you know about it?
Well, basically you just need to agree to let us track all of your movements. This will just easily plug into your car. We'll track your movements, upload it online. Probably the cloud will be really helpful, so we can just kind of see if you're a safe driver.
Mm. Well, I saw in a Forbes article that these things could be hacked. Do you know anything about that?
Forbes? Huh, I don't think so.
Is it safe?
Very safe. And effective.
Well, I guess I'll go with this. It seems like a good thing to try.
You're making the right decision.
Sweet.
And sure enough, he had a big story on CIA corruption coming out. He was in contact with WikiLeaks and was about to do a big data dump. And the official WikiLeaks has come out and said they talked to him 1 hour before his car blew up. And he said, the FBI's after me. They're investigating me. We've got to hurry up and get this done. Well, they got you done. And the police instantly said no foul play, which is always suspicious. The engine got blown down the road. Witnesses said the car caught on fire and blew up driving down the street.
Yes, I have the target now. No, it isn't the ringleader. It's codename Little Biggs. Yes, the target is in a vehicle. Do I have the go-ahead to terminate? Roger, standing by for clearance. Roger that. Termination is a go. Cutting brakes. Disabling airbags. Accelerating car to a high speed. The target is no longer a threat. One down, five to go.
That was a great report, Joe, and it showcases some of the great graphics we have here in our graphics department. The head of that being Darren McBreen. He is a wizard, digital wizard, yeah, with all this stuff.
He's Gandalf the Grey at graphics. But yeah, I mean, that's a video that took us about 3 days to make, and almost everyone in the studio helped out in some kind of way. Marcus Morales, Joe Jennings, Travis and I, you know, Josh Owens, Darren McBreen, myself.
Shipping guys.
Yeah, I mean, the shipping guys. I mean, we all got together, came up with a cool script, set up the green screens, and just made it happen.
We actually had the shipping guys help out in the other one, too. We grabbed a couple of them and said, you're going to be veterans here, yeah, in the waiting room. And it just shows how we all come together, mm-hmm, to put something out that we hope is really impactful and gets other people thinking about this stuff. And sometimes we get a little, you know, sensational or get a little flashy, but that's all a part of getting the message out to people, mm-hmm, and waking people up, because, you know, they say millennials now have the attention span less than a goldfish. So we really have to work on upping our game to get people engaged and interested in stuff. So hopefully we can make some positive changes in this country and world.
And that's right. And that's what happens when you guys support us at prisonplanet.tv. When you go get a membership and you see the nightly news, the special reports, the rants, that's what your dollars go to support. And we also have a special report from Rob Duke.
And this is actually part of a nightly news segment that I did back in April 23rd of this year. And it centers around a document that came out in 2011, or at least it was signed in 2011, by one of the vice presidents of GlaxoSmithKline. And it's with the Inforex Hexa vaccine. They did a test on it, a trial run, and plus they were studying its effects after it went onto the market. And they found at least five different instances that particular vaccine caused autism. And this is not a well-known document. A lot of people don't know about it. This report only has 11,000 views. It should have 2 million views, because people always talk about there's no proof vaccines cause autism. Yeah. Well, the proof is in the pudding right there in that document. I even show people where it is in the document so they can see it for themselves. And I just think, you know, I had them actually cut down that little part for this little segment here, just so people will see it and watch it and hopefully spread it around to their friends. So when they say there's no proof, there's no scientific proof, there it is. And in addition to autism, it causes a lot of other problems. There's a million other problems in that sheet. You can just read them all. And it's really disturbing that is a signed document and nobody knows about it, and except for a few people in the know in the industry. And we need to put this stuff out here to more parents who are thinking about getting vaccinated, and especially their children, getting their children vaccinated. So let's go to that now, and I think we have one more after that. Vaccines cause autism, says confidential document from corrupt drug company. Well, who is the corrupt drug company? It's GlaxoSmithKline. And it's a huge document. It's thousands of pages long. And they say that in the article. You really have to do your digging. Here's the front cover page. And it's on the Inforex Hexa. Hexa stands for how many diseases they're going to pump into you at that time. They pump in six, diphtheria, tetanus, pertussis, hepatitis B, and a couple other things I can't really pronounce because I'm not a scientist. I'm just a stupid American that had a public school education. But this is a hexavalent vaccine. And here it's signed. Let's look. It's signed by Dr. Felix Arlano, who's the vice president, head biological clinical safety and pharmacovigilance, head of GlaxoSmithKline Biologicals. And there's the date he signed it, and there's his signature. Okay. Signed document. And you can print the 1,000+ pages of this if you want. Signed document. And all you have to do is go to the link. It's provided in the Natural News article. And then you go to a search form. Show them how it's done. You type in autism right there in the search function. And you click go. And it takes you, look, here's the first two spots. Those are on page 24. But before we get to those, I want to show you what that is. I want to list what this is. Come to me, guys, right here. So this is a table. Summary tabulation of Inforex Hexa adverse events. 23rd October 2009 to 22nd October 2011. All right, there it is, and we can see this the system class, HGLT, I guess that's what actually happens. The event, how it was it listed, is it serious or non-serious, and the total cases. Well, Now let's go to page 24, where it has it on there, because you got to go through a few pages to get to it. And it's got all kinds of side effects, people. I mean, I'm getting to page 24 of these. Woo, a lot of side effects. Almost there. It's just got a lot you got to go through. Some aren't that big a deal, like foot deformity, you know. So, mental impairment disorders, event, autism. How many events? Two. Total two. So they're mentioning right there that there's two different adverse events of autism. But there's more. If you go to Appendix 4E, cumulative tabulation of all unlisted events from serious unlisted spontaneous reports to and all serious unlisted reactions from clinical trial cases reported since launch. So this is getting them from a couple different lists, from clinical trials and from other lists that they were conducting. And you can see what it says up here, the number of adverse events and level of seriousness. That you can find on page 544. Well, you go to page 578, autism. Number of events, 5. Serious, yes. Here's another autism. Well, it wasn't too serious. You know, it was just one that wasn't too serious. But we had 5 that were pretty serious. Nothing to worry about, though. Now let's continue on. Page 584. Here it is again, listed under a psychiatric disorder. Unlike here, it's a nervous system disorder right there. Nervous system disorder. So, and then there's other tables where it lists autism. You know, you could go through and read them all. It gets actually here. And here it lists infrarex hexa, female, 5 months old. She gets autism, epilepsy, and a developmental delay. The case outcome's unresolved. It was reported that diagnosis confirmed, but no data provided. So there it is. Here's the signed cover sheet by the doctor. You can see for yourself. Go to the Natural News article. We're going to put it back up on screen. You can see the signature. Dr. Felix Arlano, MD, Vice President, Head Biological Clinical Safety and Pharmacovigilance of GlaxoSmithKline. They're keeping all the records, okay? They know it causes autism. They know it, but they don't want you to know it. So they have these congressional hearings where they get doctors up here that are most likely, when they get out of the CDC, are going to go get jobs working for these vaccine companies. And they're going to keep pushing them. They're going to keep making more lists of it. And I didn't even talk about all the other adverse events, like the epilepsy and the encephalopathy, whatever that is, encephalopathy. I can't even say all these words. But that's where your head, you're having tremors and your head expands and it starts to swell. I mean, it's horrible, the things that these vaccines cause. Yet we got to put up with all these damn cartoons and these reports that come out and all this fake news that vaccines are good for you and that we have to have them. It's a total bunch of BS and it really pisses me off.
And another great video. And I want to remind all you guys, if you're watching this on YouTube, please subscribe to the channel and you can get all the great videos. Over 1 million viewers now, yeah. Subscribers to the site. It's a great time to be an info warrior. And also, if you're watching this video on YouTube, go down to the description and you can see all of the links, so you can see these original things in their entirety. Some of them had to be shaved down a little bit, but you can
send these reports out. Send these reports out to people you know. Spread the word. Help these videos grow. It increases the awareness of what's really going on in this country. And it's stuff you're not going to see on the mainstream media.
Absolutely not, because the mainstream media is going to make fun of you if you dare question the vaccines. And I did a report earlier this year myself talking about how these late night guys, they want to poke fun at you if you're a parent who dares question vaccines. Even though we've seen the kids in Syria die after taking the vaccines. We've seen the kids in Mexico die after taking the vaccines. And then they put you on Katie Couric right next to the girl who has the very serious condition after taking the vaccines. And the doctor's like, oh, well, it's so rare. It's a very, you know,
it's so rare, but your kids aren't taking them.
Yeah, you know, so it's completely ridiculous. We see Dr. Oz and some of these other guys not taking these vaccines. So definitely be aware of this and also check out all these reports. Now, we're going to end tonight with this. This is a special report actually done by Leanne McAdoo and Josh Owens. World's oldest World War II veteran speaks out. This is Richard Overton. He's a very nice gentleman who lives right here in the city of Austin, Texas. And before we go to this, Joe Biggs, let's say you're 100 years old. You know, Joe Biggs, 100 years old. Can you even fathom what the world is going to be like so many years from now?
I mean, like you said, with the aborted babies being used, the organs and all that, the fact, I mean, by the time I'm 100, I mean, we should be floating by then, like in cars. I mean, we wouldn't have driverless cars.
Just your head.
Well, yeah. It'd be like Mars Attacks or something. I'm kind of fearful for that far away, just the way things are kind of spiraling out of control so rapidly. I mean, I don't know if it's one of the things I'm looking forward to at this moment in time.
All right,
fair. Well, I'll say this. You know, technology has always been kind of ahead of where humans want to be. You know, people are always pushing the boundaries, and I think we should be pushing the boundaries of technology. But we also need to be having those discussions of, is this the right way to go with the technology, especially with robots? And how many robots do we want out there replacing
our cars? I mean, we really have a system out there called Skynet.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, Skynet is real. It's real. It's not just in the Terminator movies. It is very much real.
It is real.
It's totally crazy. But yeah, I'll be in 60 years, I'll be 100. And, you know, hopefully we have flying cars by then, because I've been waiting for flying cars since I was a little boy.
The Jetsons.
Boy. Yeah, I've been waiting for something like that. Now we're seeing guys make, you know, hover scooters and stuff like that. And I want to see more of that type of technology.
Yeah,
that frees us from, you know, the traffic. I can't stand traffic. Hopefully we'll have traffic beat by then, but they'll probably do it with these damn driverless vehicles.
Yeah, it makes everything more efficient. So this is the world's oldest World War II veteran. He speaks out. This is Richard Overton.
109.
109.
Trying to make 110. I think I'll make it.
Yeah.
I hope.
So do you think the world is better now or back then?
Oh, the world's a whole lot better, but there's some things are getting a little different. People are getting a little stronger. Getting a little meaner. Shooting the police, and they're killing each other, and they think having fires every night. And now that didn't happen when I was in the country. Mm. That wasn't happening, but none of it happened.
Well, what about during the civil rights era? Were you involved in that at all? And how was that here?
Well, back in the old days, a lot of us couldn't meet with each other, but only way a lot of them got together is when war started. That changed the situation, changed a lot of them. Because when you were left here and go to the army over the water, fighting for this country, well, you got to get together. You couldn't separate. But just think, all the soldiers that Uncle Sam had, and how in the world I can get to be the oldest. I can't believe that. Man didn't do it, did he? I don't think so. Sometimes I stop and look back and say, what in the world behind me? See what pushed me. See what kept me going.
Well, I read somewhere that you like coffee with whiskey in it.
It's good medicine. That's what I've taken it for. My daddy taught me how to do that.
So what do you think about the Second Amendment? Do you think that's important for us nowadays, or do you think we should do away with the right to bear arms?
No, I think everything getting something. It was better here for a while, but it seemed like it's kind of changing a little bit.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know whether it's the people changing. I don't guess God will change it. He don't go the bad way, he go the good way. But some of these things are getting pretty bad in places. And a lot of people coming over here and you don't know them, and they, like here a few days ago, some fella stopped out there with his hat down and wouldn't let me see him. And some fella stopped up there working on his car on the dash and wouldn't let me see him. Every time I look at him, they would drop their head. And there were some people that didn't belong here, but they found out that I've been in this situation for some time. And they know I live by myself. And so they think I got some money. I kept looking at him, looking at him. Every time I look at this stuff, you hear a dot down on his car. I look back there, he put this over here in the car, he put his hat down. So I said, oh, well, it ain't gonna worry me, because I just got up and come in and got my gun. When I'm on the push, I said, now y'all just keep do whatever you want to do. Then I called, I had called the police long. I called him several times out here. and tell them what I got to do, because people are getting funny. He said, I know it. He said, people are getting kind of funny. He said, the way to do it is, one, come on your steps out there on your walk. Well, if he come up to your walk and want to say something to you, you can talk to him. But if you want to come up on your steps and you don't know him, you tell him to wait. So you can't come no further. I don't know. You can't get close to me. See, some of them get close to it and grab you. See, and some of them stronger than you are. Mm-hmm. And so you don't take that chance. He said, if they come up on the step, if you want to kill them, be sure you kill them, because they'll come back and kill you if you don't.
Do you think the world is more free now?
Yes, well, the world is getting better. Yeah, it's getting better because things is now. Some year things go up and then some year things go down. So mm-hmm. You just got to live through what's coming.
Well, before we go, is there anything you want to say to the veterans, to the young veterans, or to the young people out there? You've got a lot of wisdom, so.
Yes, and you tell them I'm still their friends. And they want me to go back to Washington. I didn't want to go, but they want me to go back again, talk to the president. So I go back and see what's going on, but I want everything to be lovely. I don't want nothing to be crossed up where I don't like.
Well, how does that make you feel, being the oldest living World War II veteran?
I just can't believe it. I can't feel it. I just can't believe it. But see, man ain't got to do with it. You got to go up and ask God about that situation.
Yeah.
I don't know how I'm going to live. I'll have to live 5 more years. I'll die tomorrow. But man ain't got no thing about it till I'm dead and gone. But God got to know when you die. He know when you're leaving and know when you come. Mm-hmm. And so that's the man you better watch.
Yeah.
And thank him for giving you that all a good life, and I had a good life.
And guys, that's just a very small selection of the reports that we put out every single day. You know, whether it's the nightly news, the Alex Jones Show, the special reports, all the other things that get up on YouTube, the iPhone videos. This is all the stuff you guys see if you go to the Alex Jones channel on YouTube or you go to PrisonPlanet.tv.
That's right. And I would definitely encourage people to become a member of PrisonPlanet.tv because it helps pay for the flights to send these guys all around the country and keep them with the best equipment that we can get, you know, without breaking the bank. Because some of
this equipment, we don't have a million-dollar satellite truck. We are doing the best of what we can.
Yeah, we got to use small, like, iPhones and selfie sticks and some really small rechargeable batteries.
Just the Teradek, the piece of equipment that we use to do the live streaming, that was several thousand dollars.
Yeah.
You know, this stuff doesn't just fall out of the sky. It's because of people like you out there who are subscribers to Prison Planet. Also people that watch the videos on YouTube, mm-hmm. You know, everything helps out. People who go to InfoWarsStore.com. We appreciate all your support and we do put it back into this operation. And everybody here is totally committed to what we're doing.
One big family.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Well, that's going to do it for our show tonight. We definitely thank you guys for spending your Memorial Day with us. We hope you have a very safe and productive time, and we'll see you back tomorrow night.